Alright, so the GMMK Compact 2 from Glorious, beautiful name, has been my daily driver for about like a year probably, and it's a very nice keyboard. I think what happened to me is that in the past few months, I would say, I'm starting lacking the F row that was really, really necessary for me to be able to do certain tasks that I didn't do before. I used to play a lot of video games, but because I lack time now, I'm mostly doing, I would say, computer work, like designing things on 3D softwares, or, I don't know, developing a few things, and the F row sometimes comes very handy, because I think in video games you don't really need it, not that much. In this kind of work, workflows, you probably benefit from having it. So yeah, from that point, I decided to make myself an upgrade, to my personal rig, and I selected the, I'm looking at it because it's right next to me, I decided to go with the X75, actually, because of the color, basically. The color sold me, not gonna lie to you, the color was really appealing. It's rare to find pink keyboards, and my setup is toward pinks. So yeah, I decided to go with that one, and I absolutely do not regret my choice. It's a very, very nice keyboard. It has a lot of good features for the price that it's retailed at. It's around $50-$60, if I'm not wrong, depending on where you buy it. If you buy it in retailers, you can probably find it for a little bit more. So I'm gonna reuse that keyboard using pudding keycaps that one of my friends gifted to me. Again, they're pink. So I'll be using that board for home office every time I am at home. For that new update, I also updated the switches, because I've been using on the Glorious the Gateron Reds that are actually spring swapped. So I used a 68 gram spring, sorry, on these switches, because I really like heavy switches. So I'm also gonna, I'm using new switches for the new board. So the board is the Nextime X75, which is obviously a 75% with F-Row and a couple of other keys. And the switches are the JWICK Pink Jade. They're 62 grams, they're factory lubed. I actually found a couple of them that were over lubed. So yeah, some of them had a big of a sort of a blob on top of them. On top of the rail, so I chose to remove the factory lube. It was very time consuming, but I decided to remove the factory lube and apply mine to make sure that the lubing is consistent. Since I'll be mostly working on this board, it can be very distracting when some of the keys are a bit rattly, or you know, in terms of comfort, you can feel the difference when you press the key, that some of them are a little bit more scratchy or a little bit more resistant. Or less resistant in the other way. This can be a bit distracting depending on what you're doing, at least for me. So yeah, this is a polycarbonate helper housing for the switch, a polymer nylon bottom housing, and a pump stem. Very classic. I think most switches nowadays are following that that composition. Some of them have also polymer top housing, but I think it's pretty rare now, at least most of them are following that one. But yeah, for the looping, very easy. I just looped the side rails like almost every linears. Donated the spring so that it doesn't ping anymore, so that it doesn't make this metallic sound when you're pressing the key. And so I looped the side of the stems, and yeah, I think that pretty much it. You just clip it back, and then it's all good. I used the G loop to loop all of my switches. This is the one that I had in hand. This is not usually the one I use for my switches. I prefer Cradox Grade 205. I had that one on hand. It's a very nice lube. I think it's a little bit thicker, but it's good enough. You just have to go very low amount of lube and it's all good. And yeah, basically this is how you lube one switch, right? But then you have to do the 74 others. So yeah, I made a small montage for you to see how time consuming it was. So the board is a 75%, it has a knob, and I think this was one of the things I really wanted to have, and that's one of the reasons why I chose that board. The knob is very convenient depending on what you're doing. If you're doing video edition or photo editions, you can remap that key into whatever you want, so it could be contrast, brightness, these kind of things. So it's very convenient, or just a timeline if you just want to move around a timeline with your video with the knob. It's very, very nice. This entire board is hot-swappable, so you can remove all of the switches without soldering. And the barebone kit exactly cost me $67 in pink. So you have different colors that exist. You have yellow, black, blue, pink, and I think there is also white and transparent. So to open it, you have to remove the knob and then to flip the board, and then you would find some plastic pegs that you have to unclip. I use a screwdriver because this is the one of the easiest way not to damage the board, damage the plastic. Once you open it, you will be greeted with the PCB. You will have to remove the top part. The PCB is connected with a single wire to a very tiny USB-C board, and you have a couple of screws to remove if you want to remove the PCB plate. It is factory foamed. You have some sort of elastic foam at the bottom. It is a nice one, I would say. Quality seems very cool, but I would say this is, to my taste, not enough to remove the plastic sound when you're pressing, for example, the space bar. It will sound a little bit hollow. So I've added some POM foam that I had. So the name of the foam is Pomerone, I think. It's a sort of like rubbery material that is very dense. So I added this alongside taping the board. So adding the tape at the bottom of the PCB is called Tempest mode, because I think the person who discovered that was called Tempest, at least it was his nickname. So when you put this this layer of tape, so I put three, usually it's in between two or three, it really depends of how tight your board case is. Adding that tape is actually removing some of the, it's blocking the sound from the switches, so that when you press the key, what you hear is actually the sound of the switch and not the sound of the vibration of that switch towards the rest of the board. So having that Tempest mode plus the foam really reduces, I would say, the parasite noises. So for example, the sound of your plastic housing, or the sound of the metal plate that is on top of the PCB that is making some contact with your key. So you can reduce a lot of that noise. So on the PCB, I also modded the stabilizers exactly where the stabilizers are landing or sitting. I used sports straps because it's very elastic, so it's very easy to work with. Usually people use Band-Aid. I didn't have any textile Band-Aids, I only had plastic Band-Aids at home, so I used this because it is a sort of textile, and the reason why you want textile is because you're going to apply a layer of lube on that textile, so that it is a little bit more gummy in terms of texture, and to dampen the sound even further. So adding this allows you to remove the rattly sound that some of the stabilizer do, because it is getting into contact with the PCB. So after doing this, I also looped the stabilizer, obviously. These ones didn't need any clip because they're the ones that do not have these extra legs. So they were really nice. I also realized by doing this that you could also use screw-in stabilizers. This is what I have on the Glorious board, the one that I used previously. It is very comfortable to use screw-in stabs. I wanted to give it a try with the stock stabs by just modding them lightly. I didn't find the need of switching back to the screw-in, so I will leave them on my workboard. But yeah, in case you want to, you can also use screw-in stabs. I don't know if all of them will fit. I didn't take any measurements. But I think you can find the information online. It shouldn't be that hard if you want to make sure that yours will fit. I know, for instance, that on the Glorious I had a few issues, especially for the left shift, to fit my screen stabilizers. But overall, the stock stabs really satisfies, really impressed. So once all of this is done, I've added the switches because I was pretty much done with the modding. So once all of the switches were on, I used the keycaps that I had on my previous board, because these are the keycaps that I use all the time. And one of the final touches that I really wanted to add is a gold knob. I was about to say gold plated, but no, it's not gold plated. It's just probably brass that is colored. But yeah, I think all in all, it looks really nice. I think the colors all together mix really well. The switches are also extremely comfortable. I have a small sound test for you so you can compare the GMK to the new board, so you can see what's the kind of differences we're looking into. But I would say overall, the experience of typing on that board is very comfortable. The only thing that you have to keep in mind is that there is no legs at the bottom. I'm not sure if there's actually a word for that, but there's no legs at the bottom of the board, so you cannot incline it all up or down. It is just sitting flat on your desk. It has a slight curve. It's actually curved inwards and then upwards, it looks like. It has this kind of wave when you're looking at it on the side. It's not really pronounced. It's very, very light, but it has a very tiny curve that way, or at least it's very flat and then it starts moving up. To me, it is completely enough. I do not need something any higher, because if I use something higher, my wrists are breaking and then it causes pain. So I usually use it flat. I would recommend using a wrist rest if you're someone who like to have contact with your wrist, because you would have to be... The position at first is very unnatural if you're used to keyboards that are mounted upwards. So I might buy a wrist rest, especially for, I would say, boring tasks, like for example, derushing videos, which is probably the thing that is the least fun ever. And when you're just like doing cuts to clean up the clips. So I think I'm gonna buy a wrist rest at some point just to finish it up and make it a little bit more comfortable. But yeah, overall, very pleased and very satisfied with the board, and especially for the price. I think overall, if I count everything that I spent, that board cost me something $120 or $130, and I think it's a very, very nice price for what it is. The keycaps are something around $40, and then all of the rest is $67 for the board, and somewhat $30, $40 for the switches. So here are the sound tests side by side so we can compare both keyboards. Alright, so that's gonna do it for today. This was a small upgrade for my computer, but I'm very pleased with the result. I think it looks really nice, especially with the pink mouse that I'm using, and the pink controller that I have. The only thing is that the camera sometimes does not pick up the color correctly, so my mouse looks a lot darker than it is. They're actually very similar in terms of color. But yeah, I don't really know why it decided to pick up a different color. So yeah, thank you for watching. I hope to see you in the next one.